whenever you buy a product, you want to know exactly what it is you're getting, and also, obviously, how much it's going to cost. The Bible puts it this way, Jesus puts it this way, when he says that nobody enters into a task or begins to build something without first adding up the cost, not knowing does he have enough to finish it. No one enters a war without knowing the same thing. Well, if that's the case with us, then so too is it with God, right? So he is not going to enter into something without knowing what he's getting himself into. How does that relate to this whole issue of sin and salvation? When we look at salvation and we think about it as compared to our sins, the question that comes up is, did he die for all of our sins, and how so? Especially the future sins. Obviously, when we became believers, all of our sins were future as far as compared to when he was on the cross. And so the payment that he made, he obviously paid for some future sins, but does that mean that he paid for future sins after we come to know Christ? Are the sins after that, that we've trusted in Christ, are those sins also forgiven? The issue is always going to be perspective, right? Our perspective is typically how we look at things. We don't usually look at things from others' perspective first, but it's usually ours, first, second, and third. But if we really want to be honest, we need to look at it more from God's perspective. Remember, when God looks at us, he looks at us knowing our beginning and our end. He knows exactly what we're going to do. He knows what we're going to do. He knows what we're not going to do. He knows what we would do if these things would have occurred. And so he's got all this knowledge, and he's not just sitting everywhere at the same time. He is at every time at the same time, meaning he's at the past just as much as he is in the future, just as much as he is in the present. So there's nothing that escapes him. There's nothing that escapes his eye. He is ever present, always watching. And so when he purchases our salvation, he knows what's going to come with that. He knows what kind of person we are, what we're going to do in 10 years, in 20 years. He knows every little small detail. Again, he knows the very hair of our heads. So he knows what's going to happen at 4:35 Eastern Standard Time in 4 years in New York City or in Dallas or in Chicago or in Myanmar or what have you. And so knowing all of our faults, all of our filth, all the trash that we're going to accumulate, he still decides to save us. He still decides to purchase us. Well, why is that? Well, because God is in the business of rehabbing old defective products. He's in the business of reconciliation. And so when he wants to reconcile something, when he wants to pay for something, obviously he thinks about what the cost is going to entail. And so when it comes to us, the cost is pretty significant, right? And why is that? Well, in order for him to be in our presence, or the other way around, in order for us to be in his presence, he can't have these dirty, unrighteous vessels before him. He can't have people unjustified, people who have sin against them before him. Well, since there's a problem, there needs to be a solution. And so what is the solution? Well, the solution is, as it has been, the atonement. When you think about the atonement has three parts, three things you need to think about. One, covering. Two, a cancellation. And three, a reconciliation. As a matter of fact, when we talk about this, you could even look at it as though the first two leads to the third. There's a covering and a cancellation in order for there to be a reconciliation. And what do I mean by those terms? I mean this. There's a covering that has to be this covering of a sin. This sin can't continue to be present before God. There's this cancellation of the debt. There's a debt that's owed. Every sin produces a debt owed to God. It's a stain. It's a mark. It's a blot against us. And so that has to be canceled. And then after that, there's this reconciliation. The people are brought back together. And God has always been about reconciling people. Think about the fall in the garden. After they sinned, what did he do? Because of their shame, he covered them up and they could still have a fellowship with him. It even was so that it came to be in the course of time where they brought about an offering to God. Remember the whole issue with Cain and Abel? Well, what's that for? Well, that's for a reconciliation. That was even before the law. And then in the law, and this is important that we understand this, there came about out of the law or in the law, the atonement. The biggest problem as it relates to salvation, where people go off and get things wrong, is because of a misunderstanding of the atonement. So let's do a real quick recap. The atonement we find all the details in Leviticus, particularly 16. And there is this priest who needs to have his sins atoned for before he goes into the Holiest of Holies and before he intercedes on our behalf or on the people's behalf. There is this scapegoat whose sins of all the people are confessed and cast on the head of the scapegoat. Those sins that are on the scapegoat are sent away out of the camp. Are you following so far? Then there's another element that is the sacrificial lamb. There is this blood of this bull, of this goat, who is sacrificed, whose blood is shed upon the altar, and then God will accept the sacrifice. If God accepts the sacrifice, then the people's sins are atoned for how long? For 1 year. Why there needs to be a really good understanding of this is that, remember, when this happens, the person is deemed before God as justified. There's nothing that God holds against them until later there is a need for another day of atonement. So this occurs every year. So for that person, for those people, their sins are atoned for 1 year. Then it has to happen again. So during that period of time, their sins are atoned for. They are in right standing before the Lord. Are you with me? So when it comes to this question of are we forgiven for future sins? Well, in the context of the atonement, during that 1 year period of time, their sins are atoned for, even those that occur after the 1 year, after the atonement. So, so the same holds true with us. When we sin, even after Christ pays a debt, all of our future sins, past, present, and future sins, they're all covered. They're all forgiven. Why? Well, the same mechanisms that's there in the old covenant form of atonement is also present in the new form of atonement. Remember, God is the one who is initiating this. God is the one who's orchestrating this. And we know in Philippians 1, he says that he, God, who began a good work in us, that is salvation, he began this in us. We didn't initiate this. He initiated this. And so he, God, who began this good work in us, it is he who is faithful to complete it, right? And then we look at what Paul says about this issue of salvation, even regarding this in Romans 8. Let's go there real quick. And so let's go to verse 29. As for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. Very important. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. Then he says, what then shall we say to all these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for all of us, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? So now here's what he says, and here's the important part. Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of the Father, of God, who indeed is interceding for us all. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Right? He said, now look at this. No, in all things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor things present, nor things to come, future, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creation will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. So he goes through a litany of things that could possibly happen. He's not specific because he would be there all day. There's not enough ink and paper to write about all the possible sins or things that we can think of. And he says, nothing, whether it's present or future, anything to come, nothing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, right? And he says that because of all of this, we are more than conquerors in him. I know that's not going to necessarily nail it or sell it for some people, but I've got some more. So let's just kind of ride with me for a little bit longer. Some are going to say, when you become a believer, you have to repent. Now, some people have kind of misunderstood what it means to repent, meaning that you have to keep repenting every time that you sin. Well, repentance isn't something that you do. Repentance is something that you become. It doesn't mean that you just stop sinning. Now, you should sin less. You're not going to become sinless, but you will sin less. repentance, or to repent means to, it's the Greek word, some of you already know this, metanoia, which means to change your mind about something, to kind of turn around. Even in the Hebrew, shub, it just seems to mean to return or turn around. And so it's the idea that maybe I don't sin like I used to, I'm still going to sin, but it's the attitude, it's the heart behind when I sin. It grieves me. My whole disposition towards sin has changed. I don't look at it or view it the way I used to. When I mess up, it bothers me. I don't like it. Whereas before I repented, whatever, it's sin, you know, I'm not perfect. And so a person who has a repentant heart changes how they feel about it. And if it bothers them, what do you do about things that bother you? You want to fix that. You want to get it out, get it away from you, right? Same thing with this repentant heart towards sin. So consider this 100-year-old believer on his deathbed. As he's dying, he's been a believer for, let's say, 80 years. He became a believer at age 20. So for 80 years, he's been a Christian. He had some sins in his life at age 20. Some of those same sins are going to be persistent in his life even up till his deathbed, 80 years. Because at age 100, is he a sinless man? No. Again, if anyone says he does not sin, he is a liar. Well, here's a devoted believer who at age 100 is about to go and be with the Lord. And on his deathbed, he still has sin. Are these brand new sins? No, these are sins that he's been struggling with since he was 20. Hopefully not to the same degree, to the same tune. Hopefully some of the sins that he had at age 20 are no longer present, but then there are going to be some sins that he just could not dodge. Paul had the same issue. He's not alone in this regard. He said that the good I want to do, I don't do. The bad things I want to stop doing, I keep doing. Because though inwardly we had been saved, the one part about us that has not been saved nor will ever be saved is this flesh. This isn't going with us to heaven. Thank God, because when I get to heaven, maybe I'll get some hair back, right? Maybe my visions will be better. I'll have a perfect body. Hopefully it's my 20-year-old body versus this older version of me. And so Paul says that, yeah, we sin, but grace abounds. But now he did say that should we continue in sin, that grace should abound? Should we continue just to act the way we want to act just because we've got grace? Well, the people that do what they want to do aren't believers. I don't care if you call yourself a Christian, an atheist, whatever. If you behave a certain way, it's an indication that you're not his. People who are his have a repentant heart. People who do not have a repentant heart are not believers. I don't care if they call themselves believers. And what happens is we get confused and get caught up because someone called themselves a believer. And we assume that, well, this guy can't be saved anymore. He lost his salvation. The guy was never saved to begin with. But because we look and take him at his word, which I don't know why we should look at his fruit, how his heart is. Now, granted, we are not going to ever be able to judge everyone's walk because we're just not with them all the time. Thankfully, everyone can't do the same for us, because if they see us on our worst day, how would they see us? If we saw Peter on his worst day, the day that Christ is being crucified, the day that he betrays Jesus and denies him, you see Peter those couple of days, there's no one that's going to think that he's a believer. No one. But we know better now, don't we? And so just like God, who remember he said to Peter, you are going to deny me. And then what does he say after that? He said, but when you return, so God knows, again, your beginning and your end, and they're all the filth in between. He's going to take all this junk and turn it into a jewel. So just like he knew what Peter was going to be, how he's going to deny him, he knows us as well. And he still decides to purchase us. And so I said, a misunderstanding of the atonement causes this problem. And so let's look at how the atonement, how even this issue of future sins is even addressed in Hebrews. Let's go there. In Hebrews 9:23, it says, thus it was necessary for the copies. Remember, he's speaking about to these Jews about the atonement. And he's kind of equating the Day of Atonement with this new atonement now. And he's comparing how it was in the old with the old priest versus with the new priest, with the old elements versus the new elements. So he says, thus it was necessary for the copies of heaven, of the heavenly things, to be purified with these rites, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. Here it is. For Christ has not entered not into the holy places made with hands, which are copies of things, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God on our behalf. Nor was it to offer himself repeatedly, as the high priest enters the holy places every year with blood not his own, for then he would have to suffer repeatedly since the foundation of the world. But as it is, he has appeared once for all at the end of the ages to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And just as it is appointed for man to die once, and after that comes the judgment, so Christ has been offered once to bear the sins of many. He will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly waiting for him. So let's kind of put a pause on it. Let's see what he's talking about. Let's go back over what he's talking about. He's not like the old priest. He didn't have to have his sins atoned for, but he makes, rather than making a yearly sacrifice, he makes a sacrifice once. That's all that's required. Why? Because his blood is more valuable. It's a lot better than what the priests have been doing. Let's go to chapter 10, verse 1. For since the law has but a shadow of good things to come instead of the true form of these realities, it can never, by the same sacrifices that are continually offered every year, make perfect those who draw near. So notice he keeps talking about and contrasting what Christ did, which was just once, versus this yearly need to have this done over and over again. Otherwise, verse 2, would they not have ceased to be offered, since the worshipers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have any consciousness of sins? If they were once cleansed, there would be no need for this. But they have this thing that happens to them every year, and so Christ pays the sin, the debt, once, and that's enough. Verse 3, but in these sacrifices, there is a reminder of sin every year, for it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. The issue is taking away sin, not that people are going to not sin again. It's the effect of sin. Verse 5, consequently, when he came into the world, he said, sacrifices and offerings you did not desire, but a body you have prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have no pleasure. Then I said, behold, I have come to do your will, O God, as it is written in the scroll of the book. When he said above, you have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and burnt offerings and sin offerings, these are according to the law. Verse 10, and by that will, we have been sanctified through the offering of Jesus Christ once and for all. Right? So we've been sacrificed to Jesus Christ once and for all. How many times were we sanctified through sacrifice? We were sanctified, past tense. Now we're going to see this same word being used in the participle form, a continuing sanctification, versus a past tense, having been sanctified. And every day the priest stands daily, and every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices which could never take away sins. But when Jesus Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he offered a single sacrifice for sins. He sat down at the right hand of God. One sacrifice for all sins. Are you guys seeing what I'm reading? One sacrifice for all sins. He's using the word sins, plural, and he says, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting for the time until his enemies should become his footstools. Now look at verse 14. He says, for by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. By one offering, not a repeated offering that was required. That meant they had to do this every year, over and over and over again, because the next year you might not be atoned for. You might not be in just or right standing before the Lord. And so in this case, what Christ does, he offers one sacrifice, one. And what does he say? He says, by a single offering, he has perfected those who are being sanctified. So again, we were sanctified. What does that mean? We were set apart in the beginning. He chose us in the beginning. Chose us. He set us apart. When he chose us, had we acted as though we were set apart? He has said, by a single sacrifice, that thing, that single sacrifice that Christ did, he perfected us for all time who are being sanctified. So we're in this process of sanctification. We were sanctified. We are being sanctified. He is sanctifying us, this working in us. And but in that process, we are seen as perfected for all time. All time includes the sins that we're also going to do from now going forward. All the sins, all of our future sins. Are you with me? So even though, remember, God, again, I said, he has not gotten into some deal that he can't get out of or he doesn't understand. I didn't know this was going to happen. You sold me a defective product. I didn't know the thing was going to break down. He knew full well what he was getting into. And there was a sacrifice paid on our behalf for the believers. And he has perfected us for all time. Let's drop down to verse 16. He says, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, declare the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts and I will write them on their mind. Keeping in what he said in Ezekiel, that I will pour my spirit into their heart and they will never depart from my statutes, right? They will walk into my statutes. Then he says in verse 17, I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. He's never going to bring those up, past, present, and future lawless sins and deeds. Verse 18, where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer an offering of sin. Let me say it again. Where there is a forgiveness of these sins, there is no longer an offering needed. So now, I want to tell you something. I want you to pay close attention to these words as we wrap this up. He tells us that we have this boldness to enter before him. Well, we can only enter before him if we are in right standing. And he's speaking present tense of what we can do now and later. He didn't indicate that situation, that condition, that standing is ever going to change. But he kind of gives a warning. And I don't know what to really make of this warning. Is it to say that people who might believe this way might have a particular mindset? But I want you to hear this warning, and it should bother you. You can reject what he's saying. He's saying this to the Jews who believe that I've got to do this every year. It's up to me. It's almost kind of workish. I've got to have my sins atoned for every year. There's got to be a work done every year, not the one that was done by Christ. That's not sufficient. Now the ball is in my court. Now it's on me. And so what you paid for doesn't cover all the other things that I'm going to do. Here comes the warning. Be careful that you are not like some of these men who are going to or have rejected what he's doing. Are you saying, by saying that he did not pay the debt for our future sins, are you saying that you can lose your salvation? Are you rejecting what he's done? Are you saying that his atonement was not sufficient? Be careful. I'm not in a position to say that, yeah, by you saying that, you might be actually denying the very salvation you're claiming that you can lose. Being a believer means that you are believing in what he has done and that it is sufficient. I chose Hebrews 9 and particularly 10 for a reason, because people who believe you can lose your salvation run to verses 26 and 27. They don't run to the passages before where he's kind of comforting them and telling them, listen, guys, it's okay. It's all right. It's fine. You are going to endure. He paid a price for you that covers you and for you to have this boldness, this assurance, because he tells us to have this full assurance. And then look what he says later on after verse 26 and 27. It may be that those people who are saying that he hasn't paid the debt for my future sins, who believe that I can lose my salvation, it may be that he's talking to you in these latter verses. He says in verse 28, anyone who has set aside the law of Moses dies without mercy on the evidence of two or three witnesses. Verse 29, how much more worse punishment do you think will be deserved by the one who has trampled underfoot the Son of God and has profaned the blood of the covenant by which he sanctified and has outraged the spirits of grace? So it could be that you have decided, you have trampled underfoot what God has done. You have rejected the sufficiency of his blood. That could be those, I'm not saying it is. I'm not saying it isn't either, that he could be giving a warning to you about denying how powerful and how sufficient his blood is. And look what he says in verse 35. He says, therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has a great reward. For you have need of, you're going to have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive the what is promised. And so I'll go ahead and leave there. I can keep going on through the rest of Hebrews that validates what I'm saying, or go backwards. But it's important to note that not only did he die for our past sins, our present, but also our future sins. That's what he did. That's what his blood did. He knew exactly what he was getting. He did it anyway, because he knew the awesome price that was required. The blood of Jesus was more than enough to even cover our future sins. Amen.